Is it true that they open up with no warning?
Yes and no. There's often an explanation for it, but actually the surface, sometimes you can hardly see anything. And sometimes if that area hasn't been studied for the geology or the reason isn't known, it actually can happen with no warning, yeah.
Have you ever walked down the street and wondered what would happen if the ground suddenly opened up underneath your feet? Esme, some of these photos and videos of sinkholes, these huge holes that appear in the ground, are absolutely terrifying. What are the ones that stand out most to you?
I think you get a bit excited watching these, can't you? But they're actually very dangerous. I think that's the first thing we should say. But I think actually one that I think really captured kind of how scary they are, actually, there was one, I think it was at the beginning of last year in Illinois, there's this video, I think it's actually on the BBC News website, of this one opening up in a football stadium in Illinois. It was about, I think, about 100 foot wide. And I think the thing that is amazing about it is that as it kind of collapses, there's this floodlight which sort of just sinks down into it. And I think it just shows how dramatic and very quick they can collapse.
And Esme, you're a climate and science reporter, and today you're going to help us understand what causes some of these huge sinkholes like the one in Illinois. And we're going to find out if they're actually getting more common. I'm Hannah Gelbart, and this is What in the World from the BBC World Service. So there are some pretty out there theories about sinkholes. Let's take a look at them. So firstly, is it true that people can fall into them and disappear forever?
Not unless you're watching a sci-fi movie. I mean, they are very dangerous. So people have unfortunately died as a result of them, but you're not going to disappear in some vortex anytime soon.
Is it true that they open up with no warning?
Yes and no. There's often an explanation for it, but actually the surface, sometimes you can hardly see anything. And sometimes if that area hasn't been studied for the geology or the reason isn't known, it actually can happen with no warning, yeah, which makes them so scary. So that one is kind of partially true.
So leading on from the you can fall into them and disappear forever, there's this theory that I've seen that they are bottomless.
That goes completely against what a sinkhole is. A sinkhole, well, we'll come on to it, but it's a depression, which means there is a bottom to it, right. Which means, if anything, they definitely have a bottom.
And is it true that they're caused by asteroids?
No, but they can replicate them. So if you would, I mean, if you did have some sort of asteroid impact, you know, in geological history, you can get something that resembles very similar to a sinkhole. But when you think about sinkholes, we think about collapsing. So less something coming from above, more something happening below the surface.
So let's get into that now. What exactly is a sinkhole and what causes this collapse from beneath the surface?
So I kind of said that it's effectively depression, a little dip in the surface. And obviously the size of the dip can vary absolutely massively. So we get very, very big ones, we get very shallow ones, but they are effectively just a little dip. And that happens because the underlying rock has collapsed. Now, why does that happen? Well, often there are geological reasons for it. So something happening in the rock which causes that. And they are most common if you get rock that is limestone or chalk, because those types of rock, what can happen is they can dissolve in acid. So why is there acid in this rock? Well, actually, a common weak acid is something called carbonic acid. And that happens when carbon dioxide dissolves in rainwater and it percolates down. And then over time, the rock gets dissolved and then it can just effectively, it kind of gives way. And so the kind of overlying soil or any infrastructure that's on top will then collapse into it. There's also sometimes where it's really difficult to tell this is happening if that particular limestone or chalk or similar rock type is under another one. And so you won't see any cracks on the surface. It will be dissolving very slowly. And then that other type of rock then collapses very suddenly into it. It's called a collapse sinkhole. Floods and really heavy rains can make this worse because it's bringing a lot of water into the system. But also what that can do is it can flush out particularly kind of softer rock types. So if you get kind of sand, for example, you get a sudden influx of water that can force the rock out and then cause a collapse. Now, they're the kind of natural reasons why these occur, but certainly the activities of humans can make this a lot worse. And so one particular example of this is abstraction. So if we're taking a lot of water out of this system, which is, you know, not uncommon in many countries, particularly as it's getting drier for some places. And what happens then is the water table, which can kind of support the rock, then starts to go down. And so that support isn't there. And that means that, again, the rock is collapsing. And the last other main reason, which is often where we get these really big sinkholes, is due to mining activities. And sometimes what can happen is historically, if we've dug for a lot of things, this is a particularly big problem in the UK where we have a lot of old mine shafts, for example, we don't always know that they're there. And then we start building on top of them and then it eventually collapses into kind of a cave or a shaft underneath.
Are there people who go around trying to predict if and where a sinkhole might happen?
Definitely. So, I mean, mapping the geology of an area is really important, particularly if you're going to build something up. So many countries, what they'll have is as they begin to build infrastructure, they'll be looking at not just the structure of the building itself, but what's kind of going on underneath. So civil engineers will be looking at that all the time and understanding if there is an increased chance of that happening and if there's any further kind of reinforcements that need to happen. You know, you might get some movement on the surface and geologists will be kind of looking out for that. But that example I mentioned earlier, where you get the limestone or the chalk underlying another layer of rock, that can kind of cover up what's going on a little bit. And that's where you can suddenly get that collapse without anyone knowing.
I've been looking at some videos of them, and there have been some really big ones just from this year. There have been a couple in the UK. There was a big one in Japan, another one in South Korea. And it kind of looks like the ground just suddenly pulls this disappearing act. There's this huge hole. And it can happen in urban and residential areas too. Like, what is the worst case scenario?
It can be really terrifying. You know, we have had cases of people dying. You know, if your building is on top of a sinkhole, there's actually a really kind of quite awful image of one in Guatemala City. I think it was sort of over 10 years ago now, but where literally it's just the corner of a street is missing, where the building's just collapsed inside. So people can die from this. And so it is a big concern. And it's particularly a concern for those cities, for example, that might get quite extreme rain. So it doesn't surprise me that you mentioned Japan. You know, they have very intense storms. There's also kind of secondary impacts. So if you think about it, if you're getting a collapse in a very built up area, what can happen is it can collapse under sort of infrastructure below the surface. So I'm thinking like electricity wires or water pipes. So if you get that ground collapsing onto a water pipe, you can get a sudden flood. You can get water interrupting electricity or power lines. So there's secondary effects from it as well, which can be quite dangerous, which the authorities will have to get involved with.
And once you've got this huge hole, can it be filled in and repaired and you know, business goes back to usual? Or is there always a risk that it will open up again?
Well, it kind of depends on the sinkhole type. So if it's kind of an urban area and they want to fill it quickly, often what they'll do is they'll backfill it with a load of sort of sand and cement to try and solidify it. But obviously, again, like you said, they'll need to check the surrounding area. So if it's collapsed as a result of mining activity or there's kind of known historic mining activity, they'll probably end up surveying the rest of that area to determine if there's other risks nearby. If it's in a rural area or there's less built up, the method can be slightly different. So probably what they'll want to do there is almost dig down to the bottom of the depression. And what they'll do is they'll sort of put reinforced concrete at the bottom to kind of hold that layer of rock and then fill it over the top. But obviously it's a mix of like safety, speed, future risk as well.
Where in the world gets the most sinkholes?
Where they're in urban areas, we capture them, right? We have amazing videos of them. But actually, there are probably many out there that we don't even know about that are happening. It is a mixture of the geology. So definitely if it's an area that has kind of those types of sedimentary rocks that are more at risk of dissolution, that's the kind of the dissolving in this acid, that is where you're going to get an increased likelihood. But also those areas that have had historic mining activities. So for example, Wales in the UK gets a lot of sinkholes for that exact reason. It has these historic mining shafts, but also Central and South America gets them a lot, and also China. And you know, part of that is the combination of infrastructure, geology, and also the extreme weather they can get as well.
And in China, like you say, the sinkholes are actually a bit different from the rest of the world. And here is Devra Willingham from the National Cave and Karst Research Institute in the US.
I have been very lucky to go to China multiple times. That area is very wet. It has a monsoon season, and that's a big reason that these huge caves are there, but also these huge sinkholes called Tianqins. So Tianqins are different than normal sinkholes because of size. So you can have sinkholes that are small enough that your leg can fit in, but you can have sinkholes like the Tianqins, which are anything over 100 meters across or deep. These are huge places, and they're noted for having a river at the bottom. And that is what's so mind-boggling when you're in a Tianqin. And so a lot of times it's easier to get to these places, not from overland, but through the caves. When we think of sinkholes, a lot of times thinking of a flat space, and then suddenly there's a hole, so it's flat. You can usually see that this absence of this space. But Tianqins are almost like a whole entire mountain peak dipped, so you don't really see it for a lot of vantage points. You can look up and you see the hillside, but only until you go really on top and above do you really see how deep or that something is missing? And so when you go through a cave to get to a tank, and a lot of times you're talking multiple hours of travel, and sometimes this is technical. So even though multiple tankens are easy to access because they are tourist spaces, when you go to more rural places, the places that haven't been developed, you have to use technical skills. And you've been in the dark, and like now you're starting to see like a beam of light, and it's getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and you realize you're at the bottom. And you look up and it's green, and you think you're looking at bushes and you don't recognize because everything is so dwarfed by this Tianken that these bushes you're looking at are 5 to 10 meters tall.
What other things have been found in sinkholes?
So again, because it has an amazing ecosystem, some of these sinkholes host very rare species. If you can imagine, the environment's quite unique, isn't it? I mean, it's quite dark, it's a little bit more wet, so you can get some really incredible plant species. So in the heavenly pit, the big sinkhole in China, you have a particular rare type of ginkgo, which is a type of plant, very important one. It's known to be very pest resistant. It's very important in some types of medicine. You also get a clouded leopard, which finds itself in there, so it's harboring some really important ecosystem. The collapsing of sinkholes can also reveal things that we didn't know but that were there. So, as I mentioned, old mine shaft, potentially revealing new fossils. So it does depend. So that's why sometimes authorities don't necessarily want to fill them back in if they don't have to, because it could reveal something to us that we didn't know before.
So Esme, one of the things that I've been reading is that sinkholes are becoming more common because of climate change. How true is that?
So there have been some studies looking at this. There was actually one published, I think it was back in March, in Nature Geoscience, about particularly looking at the increased prevalence of Chinese sinkholes for this reason and wondering whether climate change is making it worse. Now, there is evidence to suggest this is the case, even just looking kind of back at first principles. So we know the rock isn't going to change, right? Climate change isn't affecting that. But what we do know is that climate change for some parts of the world is bringing more extreme weather. So that means we're getting more intense rainfall over a shorter period of time. If we're getting more intense rain, then potentially we could be dissolving more of that rock or flushing more of it out. So that's one element of it. We also know, kind of on the other side of that, we're also getting more extreme heat and less rainfall in some areas. Now, what happens to rock when you get less rainfall or it's drying out is you can cause this sort of cracking or shrinking of the rock. And as you can imagine, that's kind of weakening it. And it's also opening up gaps, which basically provides more opportunity for the water to kind of enter and more dissolving can happen. And then, kind of coupled with that as well, is that we see for countries that are struggling with their water supply will continue to get increased demand. How are they going to get hold of water? Well, I guess one way is building reservoirs, but if you're not getting rain, what do? Well, you try and abstract more of it from the ground. And again, that goes back to the point of sort of lowering that water table over time, reducing that support.
And it's in those areas, those urban areas, that these sinkholes can be so disastrous. But what I'm also learning about from you is that, in the natural environment, there is just so much that we can learn from sinkholes. They're almost a natural phenomenon that shows you what happens beneath the surface of the earth and all of the different kind of animals and species that can live inside them.
Yeah, it's absolutely fascinating. I mean, I studied geology at university, and something that you hear time and time again is the human obsession with digging down. We always try to dig down, see what's below the surface. And actually, these sinkholes offer us, when in a safe place, an amazing opportunity to see what's below the surface. And that's very exciting. It can reveal many things about our planet that we didn't know before.
Esme, thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
That's it for today. Thank you for watching. I'm Hannah Gelbart. This is What's in the World from the BBC World Service. Please do leave us a comment below, subscribe to our channel so you can catch up with more episodes like this, and we'll see you next time.